there's a lot that goes through your head when you're told that now you're not going to be able to do anything for yourself. It was our first day on vacation. I'm diving into a wave. I hit my head. Everything went numb. Everything became extremely serious when I first met with the doctors that said, you broke your spinal cord, you're never gonna be able to walk again, and this is how it's gonna be for the rest of your life. It really just felt like I had my whole life ripped away from me. But I'm not gonna let this define my life.
Spinal cord injuries are pretty much permanent.
But why accept these limits? Maybe we can come up with an artificial interface.
So we looked at this as an important problem to reanimate the limb of a quadriplegic.
100 years ago, the thought of someone leaving the planet and going to space was crazy. When I broke my neck, the thought of me using a computer to regain use of my body was crazy. But now that's exactly what I'm doing. My name's Ian Burkhart. I'm 26 years old, and I'm an accounting student.
Alexa, turn on the lights.
Okay.
Before my injury, I was very independent. I had just finished my freshman year of college, first time living on my own and, you know, doing everything that everyone else is doing. But that all came to a change on June 13th of 2010.
I remember distinctly it was a Sunday evening, and I got a phone call about 11 p.m. You know, he said your son had a diving accident, and he broke his spinal cord, and we think he's gonna live, but he'll never walk again.
But the first time I saw him, he really kind of sums up how he is. Because he looked at me and he said, Mom, life isn't over, it's just different.
Maybe I'll be in a wheelchair for the rest of my life, but I'm not gonna be the guy in the wheelchair, I'm gonna be Ian. So with my level of spinal cord, I can move my arms around pretty well. But I can't move any of my actual individual joints or fingers on my hand. About 2 years after I had my injury, I kept asking my doctors, you know, what can I look forward to? What's the future gonna be like? I was fortunate enough to be in the right place at the right time when they were looking for patients for this study.
In a spinal cord injury, the communication between the brain and the body has been damaged. So our idea was to create a bridge around that damaged spinal cord so that we could regain control in a limb that was paralyzed.
You've got sort of a similar pinch for another grip is going to show a similar pattern.
Exactly.
The system works by allowing the stimulation sleeve to electrically shock your muscles to make them contract and move.
We put the electrodes on and we use pre-programmed stimulation to evoke motions in the hand, wrist, and fingers that we would plan to use with the full system. If we're successful, then we enroll them into the full study.
And then came that million-dollar question.
Would you like to be able to control the stimulation device with your thoughts?
The basic three components of the NeuroLife system is the chip in the brain and the ability to collect that data, the computer that takes those signals and decodes the intent and then re-encodes those to deliver those to the third part of the system, which is the stimulation system that actually evokes the muscle motions.
The surgical aspect of the study is something that I was a little worried about. It was an unneeded surgery, and there's a lot of risk with any type of surgery, let alone a brain surgery.
Sort of the range of bad things that could happen are having a stroke, getting pneumonia, not being able to see or hear. There's always the risk of death with a surgery.
I knew that if I was able to regain any function in my hand, it was worth taking that risk of the surgery and potentially losing everything. But if this is something that I could do, it would really impact my life in a great way and be able to impact other people's lives in the future. So I was all in.
We are ready.
Rubber shop.
Ian puts himself at risk. Why do you want to go in for two brain surgeries that you don't need? One to put the chip in and another one to take it out. And the answer was that he wants to take advantage of his situation. He views it as an opportunity to advance the science and advance the field of rehabilitation medicine.
The first day where we were able to take all the parts of the system and connect them together to see if this would work was something extremely exciting, but also nerve-wracking at the same time, because no one knew for sure until we were able to connect everything together and for me to actually think about opening and closing my hand.
Good. Thanks.
That first movement was amazing. It's almost something that there are no words for, because naturally speaking, this is not something that Ian should be able to do. This should be something biologically that is impossible.
This is the first time that the limb of a quadriplegic has been reanimated using a brain-computer interface to regain fine motor control.
After we were able to get that initial movement of my hand, we really went to the drawing board and said, okay, well, now what all can we do with it?
Playing a guitar video game seems simple enough. But for Ian Burkhart, it's a major step forward.
So we've been doing sessions now the last 3.5 years. I definitely take it as a job. I enjoy it, but it's work.
If you think about all the things that Ian risked by having this surgery, it's really just staggering. He's a pioneer. We're all inspired by him.
A huge motivating factor for me to be involved in this study was other people. It gave me that huge light at the end of the tunnel, because it allows you to, you know, change the world for other people.